Good morning, Colony. My name is Joshua Jahn. I was asked to come and speak to you this morning. I was here a few years ago, and I remember it was a very, very powerful experience. And my hope and my goal is that this morning we would share a very important moment. No matter how many times you've been in this room, no matter how many times you've been on the campus of this school, I hope that today you would consider this one of the most important times that you've ever been assembled with your fellow students. Today is not about a fun event. Today is about honoring and remembering people that have been lost to something that is completely and entirely preventable. How I wish I could make that true for myself. How I wish I could turn the clock back and change what my reality has become. Three people in my life, three people that were my life, could not be here this morning. My wife, Mandy, that I had been married to for almost 8 years, on the night that we had to say goodbye to each other. My son, Ryan, 3.5 years old. And my little girl, Caitlin, just 1 week away from her first birthday. There was a time when every day, every moment that I was awake was about them. It was about keeping them safe. It was about living life as a family. They say it's important to tell those that you love how much you love them, to take the time to share those thoughts. And I can stand up here and tell you now, looking back, how true that is. Mandy and Ryan and Caitlin could not be here this morning, standing with me on this stage, but they are with me here today. And now, in front of you, a room full of strangers, I choose to open up a wound and let it bleed in front of you. It was a Thursday. Like any other day, it started off normal. It wasn't a holiday, it wasn't a weekend. It was just another day when Mandy had dropped off our kids at her mom's house. And later that day, she picked them up and she was on her way home and she called me and she said, "I'm sorry, I'm running late. Ryan didn't want to leave Grandma's house and he took my car keys and he hid them in the couch cushions." He was always doing stuff like that. And I said, "It's okay. I'm home, you know. I'll see you in a little while." And that was one of the last things I said to her. Just a few minutes after that phone call, a drunk driver who was trying to hurry home to be with her 15-year-old son after an afternoon of drinking. A drunk driver that was supposed to stop at a stop sign at an intersection where Mandy had the right of way and she didn't need to stop. But this drunk driver approached this intersection and blew through that stop sign and hit my wife on the driver's side of our car going almost 70 miles an hour, pushing both cars off of the road. Unlike what you witnessed on the video where the officer goes to the house for a death notification, I knew about it as it was happening. Mandy and I were high school sweethearts. We met young and we grew up together. And at some point we knew we wanted to be married, and through all of the ups and downs of dating, we made it. We got married in a small little church about an hour south of Chicago. And like many young couples, after we get married, we're struggling to make ends meet. We had a lot of bills to pay. We rented this small little house, and we worked a lot. I had two jobs. Mandy had two jobs. One of my jobs was as a tow truck driver. And I had to go to an impound lot and sleep on a little cot next to a phone and wait for the phone to ring. And if the phone rang any time of the night, 2 a.m, whatever it was always a dispatcher of a police department telling me where there was a collision that had occurred and how many vehicles were involved, how bad it was, if it was a rollover. Maybe it was just a DUI arrest. Somebody had gotten pulled over and was arrested for drunk driving. But that was the first time that I ever came face to face with the thing that makes people slow down on the roads when they go by a collision. Now I had a license to pull up to the scene and see these vehicles. The reality of what you witnessed yesterday, even though you knew it was pretend, now I was faced with that. But I never knew what happened to the people. Usually by the time the tow truck got called to the scene, the ambulances had left, the fire departments had left. There was just one squad car there, and I had to sign for the car and tow it away. But I remember walking up to those cars and seeing the blood on the windshields. I remember looking inside the car and seeing car seats and little baby toys sometimes. I remember the smell from alcohol being spilled all over the inside of the car as it rolled over, mixed with the smell of the airbag once it goes off. And there was a few times where I, myself, as a tow truck driver, almost got hit as I was standing on the freeway trying to load up a car. And if I hadn't looked over my shoulder, I would have been hit. So many people out there, and you don't know. I never told Mandy about how scary that was sometimes. I didn't want to make her worry. It was a job. A few years passed, and we found out we were going to be parents. And I remember when Ryan was born, my life shifted, it changed. And the first time in my life, I realized that everything I did was very, very important, because now there was this little person who relied on me for everything. Ryan loved to play. He loved to run around. He was a great kid. And as he grew, we quickly realized that this little house that we were renting was not big enough. And so we started to look for a house. And we found one that Mandy fell in love with instantly. It had just been remodeled. It was an old home, but it had been remodeled. And it was in this small little town called Dwight. And Dwight is in Illinois, and it's about 5,000 people, small little farming community. We knew a few people in town, and one of the people that we knew through an acquaintance at the church was the fire chief. So I had an opportunity to join the fire department. And I can tell you that Ryan absolutely loved that his dad was on the fire department. Now, instead of waiting for the parades to go and see the fire trucks, he could go down there with his dad anytime. He always wanted me to pull him down in the wagon to the fire station and go visit. But something changed. Because after that, now I wasn't just a tow truck driver. Now it was my job to respond as a first responder. And now I was witnessing what was happening to these people. And I will never forget the first fatality, the first fatal call that I went to. There was a young woman who was driving a car on a gravel road in the middle of the night. She had been out partying, she'd been drinking. She was speeding and she overcorrected. Her car started to swerve. The car flipped over, hit a telephone pole, and landed on its roof. And when it came down on its roof, it landed just hard enough to push the roof in and to break her neck. A passerby found the car, called 911, and we responded. When we get to the scene, the fire chief was there, and there was two other guys in the rig, and he gets out first and walks up to the car and looks inside, and he says, "Guys, it's bad. Prepare yourselves." And that night, for the first time in my life, I saw a dead body, a real. And I remember now, it was my job to help take her out of the vehicle and support the weight of her while we loaded her into the back of the coroner van. When I went home from that call, it was late at night, it was probably 2 a.m, and I didn't wake Mandy up and tell her about what happened, but I didn't want her to worry, I didn't want her to realize. Her job was to take care of Leo. Sorry, her job was to take care of Ryan. Ryan, as he grew, he watched me get more and more training on the fire department, and at some point I felt a little safer that maybe things were going to be okay, and that was all I was ever going to witness. A few years after that event, we found out we were going to be parents again. I remember we couldn't wait to find out if it was a boy or a girl. And I secretly hoped that it was going to be a girl. And in the end of November 2007, we had our little Caitlin. We decorated her room and got all of this ready so that when she came home, she had a place. And our little family grew. 2008 started with an amazing time. A lot of trips to Grandma's house, a lot of picnics, a lot of dinners. 4th of July parade with the fire department. Now you may wonder why I'm telling you all that. We spent a lot of time hearing about things that happened in the news, stories. But how often do we ever take a minute, a moment, to learn about the people behind the stories? The people, not the statistics. In 2008, Mandy's sister, Lindy, got married. And in November of that year, we propped up Caitlin in a little wagon because she wasn't old enough to walk down the aisle. And they were all in the wedding in the same church, the same sanctuary, the same room that Mandy and I had gotten married in almost 8 years before that day. Little did I know at that time what was to occur just 5 days later. On November 6, 2008, that Thursday afternoon, a drunk driver by the name of Anne Marie Getz, who was 43 years old, hit my family. She had had a history. She had been arrested and convicted 2 times before that for drunk driving. She had made some poor choices at a young age, and every time she did it, she would convince herself that, you know what, it's not going to happen again. It's going to be okay. It's not going to happen to me. And the poor choices she made at a young age cascaded into what eventually were those 2 cars meeting on that road. Now remember I said, because I was on the fire department, I knew about what was going on in the community. And that night when I talked to Mandy on the phone, I didn't think anything of it. I got off the phone with her, sat down on the couch. And just a few minutes later, my fire department radio was going off. And I heard that they were asking for an ambulance at an intersection just outside of town for a two-vehicle collision. And I thought, well, that's strange. That's right by where Mandy was. Maybe she stopped to help. Maybe she even saw something. So I called her phone, thinking she could give me an update. It went to voicemail. I called it 4 or 5 more times, and no change. I couldn't just not know what was happening. Sitting there listening to the silence, waiting. And so I decided to drive to the scene that night. And as I'm driving to the scene, I remember looking at the cars that were approaching me, thinking, I'm going to see her car. I'm going to turn around and follow her home. It was about 8 o'clock at night, and it was dark out. And there were no other lights or houses or buildings or offices nearby this intersection. And as I strained to look off into the distance, I remember I could see 2 emergency vehicles. One was a squad car and one was an ambulance. And I got about a half a mile away from the intersection, and that's when I heard my wife's license plate being read on the two-way radio. And at that moment I knew that she had been involved. My mind was telling me at that point, it's probably minor. You know, there's airbags, there's things that will keep them safe. I had no idea what I was about to witness. I parked my truck right next to the stop sign that Anne-Marie Getz was supposed to stop at. I got out, and I remember walking across the intersection, and I remember hearing the sound of the glass under my feet at the point of impact. And I looked off into the distance, into the dark. I couldn't see the cars, but what I did see was a stretcher that was being rolled towards me, and on top of the stretcher was this little person who was missing a shoe. I could see his little foot. And as he got closer to me, I realized it was Ryan. And I walked up to the stretcher, and I grabbed his hand, and I said, Ryan, Daddy's here, buddy. It's going to be okay. My mind told me he was going to sit up, give me a big hug, and say, where's Mommy? And that did not happen. His eyes were closed. His mouth was closed. There was a little bit of blood coming out of his mouth. And at that moment, the ambulance personnel told me that there was another ambulance that had just left with 2 people on board. I glanced around quickly and I said, okay, let's go, because I knew it was another 10 minutes from where we were to get to the hospital. And I watched them load Ryan into the back of that ambulance. They were giving him CPR. They closed the doors. I followed the ambulance. I was looking through a little square window with that fluorescent light, and I can see them huddled over Ryan, and they were giving him CPR the whole way. I knew that was bad. I didn't know what to do. I called my mom. I called Mandy's mom. I said, please come to the hospital. Something's happened. I don't know how bad it is. When we got there, I remember walking up to the back of the ambulance. People were rushing out of the hospital now, helping unload my son. And they recognized me. You have to remember that as a fireman, I had driven that ambulance to that hospital before. But now I was there as a father. And as the driver of the ambulance unloaded Ryan, he motioned, he shook his head. He didn't want me to see that, but I did. They rolled him quickly down a hallway, and I followed the stretcher into a small room, much like on the video, full of monitors and nurses and doctors. And there she was. There was my little girl. She was already there. I assumed, when we had left the collision scene, that the 2 people on board were Mandy and Caitlin. I was wrong. Caitlin went on the first ambulance, but she rode in the same ambulance with the person that hit them to the hospital. And they're giving Caitlin CPR now. They're trying to resuscitate her. This tiny little baby. I don't know if you've ever seen somebody give an infant CPR, but it's like time stops. That's not right. It shouldn't happen. And the nurse that was doing it was desperately trying to bring her back. She glanced at me and quickly looked back down. She didn't want to lose her concentration. It's at that moment that the sound of all of this happening in front of me was cut with a yell from a room next to where we were. The next room over, there was a woman that was yelling, "Let me up. I don't want to be here. You can't keep me here." She was screaming. It was enough to get my attention, and I walked over to the room next to where we were. And I looked in there, and there was two police officers restraining a woman to a cot. She was handcuffed to the cot. They were holding her down, and she was fighting. I couldn't see her face, but I saw her hair. It was hanging down the side of the bed. And I said out loud, I said, "That's not Mandy," because I saw brown hair. Mandy had blonde hair. And that's when I realized that I had no idea where my wife was. I heard behind me now there was a bunch of people coming into the lobby, other firemen, other people that I knew that had heard about what happened. I turned around and I started to ask them, where's Mandy? What room is she in? Have you heard anything?" And none of them wanted to say anything. They just looked at me. So I glanced around and I walked back to the room where Ryan and Caitlin were. And the doctor approached me and he stopped me at the door and he said, "Josh, I would like to ask your permission to stop CPR. We've been trying for almost 15 minutes with no response." And I said, where's Mandy? What room is she in?" And he said, "I'm sorry to tell you this, but your wife died at the scene." And I heard myself say, "All of them?" My mind couldn't handle it. My hearing started to go numb. I couldn't breathe, and they sat me in a chair. When I came to, I was watching the nurses and the doctors walk out of the room. The last nurse walked past Caitlin's bed and she stopped. And she looked at her. And she looked at me and she said, "Do you want to hold them?" And I said, "Yes." And she started to pick up Caitlin, being so careful to support her little head. And then I saw, through all of that, Caitlin's arm fell limp by her side. And I saw that, and I stopped her, and I said, wait, stop. Put her back, put her down. Because I remembered what it felt like to pull that woman out of that car on that fire call. And I did not want to remember what it felt like to hold my kids lifeless in my arms. I wanted to remember what it felt like to have Caitlin squeeze my neck and give me a big hug. Later that night, the coroner approached me and he said, "Josh, Mandy is at my office." He didn't say the word morgue. But later that night, I did go to his office and I did walk into that room. I had never been in a morgue before. And there she was, my sweetheart. She was on a table with a sheet. I kissed her forehead and I told her goodbye. And when I walked out of that room, the coroner approached me and he handed me a little plastic bag. And inside the bag was the wedding ring that I had worked so hard to buy her. A symbol of what once was. What was left. And I was the last of us, the last of our little family. There's a lot of things that I wish I could erase, but there's so many good memories. Today, after you leave here, I hope that you remember this day, that you take it with you. And much like you all have memories of your own families, I want you to meet mine. And so I have this video I want you to watch. You're going to see when Ryan took his first steps. You're going to see how much he loves his sister Caitlin. You guys are also going to see what happened to the cars when they were hit. Please watch this with me. Thank you. In the weeks and months that followed the collision, my routine ended. About 3 months after, I was asked to speak and share my story to a group of high school students. I was so nervous, I could barely get through it. I was shaking. I remember when it was over, I felt like I was alive again, because I saw, that day, the faces of the kids who understood and were going to take that message on their life's journey, much like I see your faces this morning. And that is why I share this story. That is why I choose to bleed in front of you, because I believe that events like this can save lives. I hope that you can be a part of that. Every decision you make from here going forward can change that. But I can tell you this much, it won't always be easy. It's not a matter of if, but when you are confronted with these things. It is up to us, not just the students in this room, but the adults, the parents, the staff, all of us, to make the right choices. And you won't always get a pat on the back for it. You won't always get your name in lights when you do the right thing. But when you go to sleep at night and you close your eyes and you're thinking about your day, you'll know. You will know that you made the right choice. And so today, my hope is that you feel empowered, encouraged, to go out those doors and to set an example. It doesn't just pertain to drinking and driving. There's a lot of other things that can harm friends and family. And we are all responsible for those. My family is not just a statistic. And I bring these with me when I share. These are a pair of Caitlin's shoes. And there was once a day when she would wear these and I would hold her and she used to kick me right here. I can hold these shoes, I can touch them. They are just as real as the person sitting next to you right now, reminding me, reminding us all that they were once here. And now I choose to honor their memory by sharing this story. My routine has changed. My days have changed. I used to come home. Before the collision, I would come home and I used to see. I would park in the garage behind the house. I'd walk up the sidewalk to the back of the house and I'd look upstairs into the upstairs window where Caitlin's room was. And Ryan would be up there and he'd be banging on the glass and waving, excited that I was home. And Caitlin was just tall enough to pull herself up on the windowsill and look over out into the window. And I would come into the house where you saw Ryan took his first steps in the kitchen, and Mandy would be in there, and I'd give her a hug, and all over the house would be toys and clothes, and signs of this day that had happened. And I would walk upstairs, and Ryan would always have Caitlin's door shut, and I would walk into Caitlin's room and open it really quick, and he'd say, "Surprise!" and run at me as fast as he could. Caitlin would scoot over on the carpet because she couldn't walk. And I'd pick them both up, take them down the stairs. And then we'd have our dinner, and that was my routine. After the funeral, I came home. I parked in the garage. I walked up the sidewalk. I looked up into that upstairs window. No one greeted me. I walked into the house, and all around were the signs of life. Those toys and those things were still on the floor. The house was quiet. I walked upstairs out of my routine, and I just walked into Caitlin's room. No one said surprise. No one met me. I found myself looking at that window, and that's when I saw Ryan's fingerprints on the glass. I want today to be a fingerprint in your life. I am so excited for you guys to be at the stage of life that you're at where you can be excited about your future. My goal is that no one in this room ever is the reason that someone else has to go home to an empty house. We can all make that choice today. We all share that responsibility. The power of your choice is immense. So today, the rest of the school year, as you now have your ceremonies and your proms and you go off into your summer, please remember what you've witnessed today. Please take the time to hug your loved ones and to say thank you for your fellow students that participated in this program. It took months to develop this program, and every minute of it, I think everybody in this room would agree, it's worth it. Thank you guys so much.